Right, turn with me let's look in Deuteronomy. I'm going to just go over a few scriptures dealing with Levi as the priestly tribe, and just to consider a couple of scriptures in relationship to God's view of the priesthood. I mean, it must have been, I'm just going to use this word, it must have been disheartening to God in a sense. He has a big plan. He thinks big, and his plan is he's going to raise up a whole nation of priests, and they're going to intervene and be there for the rest of the world. But instead, the vast majority don't get it. They don't get it. And so God doesn't banish all the rest of them from being part of the family or part of whatever. But he didn't just want, part of the people to be priests and part of them to not. He wanted the whole nation to be that way. The whole nation to be a people who walked in ever giving up the lamb to the Father. Ever satisfying, not themselves, but the Father. And Deuteronomy chapter 10, let's read verse 8 and 9. At that time the Lord set apart the tribe of Levi to bear the ark of the covenant of the Lord, to stand before the Lord, to minister unto him, and to bless in his name unto this day. Wherefore, Levi hath no part nor inheritance with his brethren. The Lord is his inheritance, according as the Lord thy God promised him. Promised him. He said he set him apart to bear the Ark of the Covenant. That was that they literally took up the throne, because the mercy seat and the throne are the same chair. They literally carried the throne of God and the presence of God, that throne, to wherever they went. The government, that's what I mean. The government of it was upon their shoulders. They were with the Lord. They were his body. They were not just ministers. You understand? Because this is a whole different thing. They bore the throne, the Ark of the Covenant, the mercy seat. You know, isn't that funny? That the same object that is called the throne, where when we say throne, oh, the throne of God, oh no. Oh, no, I don't want to stand before the throne of God. You know, you say, one day you'll stand before the throne of God. We all go, you know. Well, how about if we just gave it another name that's used? One day you'll stand before the mercy seat. Huh? That's the throne of grace. It's the same. It's all the same object. The throne of grace. The mercy seat. If you got that far from the brazen altar, past the laver, past the outer court, past the candlestick, seven-branch candlestick, past the table of showbread, past the altar of incense, through the veil, and you're standing there at the throne or the mercy seat, the throne of God, it's not a judgment thing. The judgment already happened back at the cross. I mean, you can accept that or not. You know, that's why it says, come boldly. You know, come boldly. But you see, you have to have his view. You have to have his oneness. You have to believe in the things he believes in. You don't have to be totally conformed to it. But you have to be pressing toward the mark of the prize of the high calling in Christ. Pressing, pressing, you know. You want to build up, you want to build up, then you're going to take something and you will press, you know, and it will burn and it will cause problems. But you're doing it with purpose. You don't ever press against anything. There's not going to be any building up. The throne of grace, the mercy seat. Only the high priest had access in there until the new covenant. The high priest was the only one that had the right to go in there, but he went in there for us, as us, and brought us in. And we're in, but we're not in the Holy of Holies unless we're in Christ. I mean, you got to see the order of this thing. It's not the outward. It's not the externals that's important. We're all working on the externals. It is the internal reality of oneness. And so, you know, he raised us up and made us sit together. Folks, resurrection, follow me if you will. He raised us up and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. How many believe that? Good for you. But you're seated with him, in heavenly places, seated on the mercy seat. Anybody ever wanted to go to the mercy seat and find grace to help in time of need? Anybody? Well, I got news for you. You're not supposed to be seeking out the mercy seat. You're supposed to be sitting on it. Delving out the mercy. Because you're him. You're one with him. You understand what I mean? You're his body. You are him. You are after his kind. See, all this body, it don't do any good to say we're his body if we're not going to be his body. The vehicle of him, not us. It's just ridiculous. It's all a lie. It is a lie unless we're going to lay hold of the truth. And so we're raised up. The resurrection then is what? The resurrection for us isn't whoopee, I'm not going to hell. The resurrection is, he's saying, whoopee, my body, my bride, that which is me is going to be like me, is going to express me. Well, you know, we all say that. Everybody knows that. We all say that. It's one of our favorite things to say. But express what? Express mercy from the mercy seat. Based on what? Deeds? That's the law. Based on the finished work of the cross alone. Death. Death. See, the truth is you don't need to die. You're dead. Paul said that, for you are dead. He didn't say you need to die. You are yucky. You need to die. The truth is, you're dead. Does that give you hope when you look at junk come out of you? Well, I'm glad. Does it give you hope for someone else when you look at junk coming out of them? It should. Well, here's our answer to that. Well, then I guess I just have a double standard. I have one standard for me, and that is that I receive mercy and grace to help in time of need. But you don't get it, and that's a double standard, and it's wrong. But folks, it's worse than a double standard. It's not being after his kind. It's not fulfilling bride. It's not fulfilling body. It's not fulfilling resurrection. Can I get amen? Yeah. I mean, it is the truth. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace. You know, even when it says forgive, anybody familiar with the concept of forgiving somebody? Even when it says forgive, it says, even as God for Christ's sake forgave you. God for Christ's sake forgave them. Now you do it. Well, I realize that I'm, you know, not really, it's a double standard, and I admit it. It's wrong. No, it's not a double standard. It's a double-mindedness. It is someone who is, but will not release what is. Release what is. Nobody deserves mercy. Not me, not you. I know you think you do. He never gives you mercy because you deserve it. Not one of you, not a one of you in this room, does he ever give you mercy because you deserve it. So even if you're really sweet and you do deserve it, he'll never give it to you for that reason. But if you think that he gives it to you for that reason, then you're going to withhold it from somebody when they're not sweet. I know. I hear the voices in the head. I hear them. They're screaming where I'm at. I can hear, oh, what about this? Well, you're just letting them go free. Folks, no, you're not. No, you're not. You are standing on behalf of the cross and the truth of the cross for them that they will die. But if you can't stand with the Lord for the cross, what are you standing for? I mean, that's a practical thing. We say, here we go again. No, I know. I stand for the Lord with the cross in the cross. I preach it. I've written stuff. I'm even writing a song, even now. And it's good. You know? That's not standing with the Lord on the cross. I'm sorry, it's not. Standing with the Lord in the cross is when it's time to delve out mercy, but not just, okay, everybody, you're scot-free. Just run like hell babies all over the place. You know, that's not what he's saying. And that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying, kids, you need to be spanked with the cross. If the Father loves you, he'll spank you. And he'll spank you good with the cross. Thank God, thank God, thank God. And you know what? You are his hand. Maybe he'll use you to spank somebody else, but you'll do it with the cross. You won't just spank them because they did something you didn't like. One of the worst things a parent can do is spank their kids because the kid did something they didn't like. You don't spank them because you didn't like that. You spank them because they need the truth. And in this case, we're talking about spiritually. You're spanking them with the cross because the only thing, you're not going to tame that nature in them. You're not going to tame all that ugliness. You didn't tame it in you. Well, obviously. You know? And you're not going to tame it in them. I mean, just wrestling with Leviathan in yourself ought to teach you something. I'm in this beast, you know, he's got all these, you know, little horns coming out of it, you know, and you're wrestling, I'll get you, you know, and you're stabbing it, and you can't get a knife or spear in there. I mean, there is no way. You know, remember the battle, do no more. That's what the scripture says. You're not going to beat the thing and win over it, and you're not going to do it in somebody else. Why would you believe for the cross in you and then not believe it for somebody else? Come on. I know. It's a double standard. No, it ain't. It's not a full embrace of the cross. It is not a full embrace of the cross. It is embracing the cross to your need on a selfish level because that's what you want and that's what you need, and you know Jesus will give it. Jonah knew God would give it to him and be merciful to him, and he was. Spit him out and gave him another chance. But he didn't want to be merciful and give anybody else another chance. See? Well, it's a double standard. No. It's a hell baby. There you go. Run amok. It is thinking a belief system is enough. And I'm telling you, okay, I'm going to tell you what maturity is. To be able to walk in Christ by the Lamb. If you're not able to do that on a regular basis with the worst of people, and I mean the word, because Jesus said anybody can love your friends and love them that love you. No, we're talking about love here, are we not? Love. Love them. Jesus said anybody can love them that love them, you know, himself back. But I say unto you, oh, Jesus, you're worse than the law. Don't say unto me. I don't want to hear it. You know. I say unto you, love your enemies. Do good to those that wrongfully do to you. Pray for them who falsely accuse you. And when it says pray, folks, it's not saying, okay, I'm going to fulfill that so I can get it off my conscience. Oh, Lord, help them, bless them, shape them up. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm sorry, man. We're so full of religion, it's pitiful. We are. It is by love, serve one another. Well, love is his nature. Maturity is when Christ begins to be real, when he begins to be life, when the worst, because I know all this because I study it in my head. There is the ungodly. We will die for the ungodly, but we won't die for the bad people in our life. You see, there's a difference somehow in our mind. We will die for the ungodly with Jesus, but it's those dadgum people that I know that are in my life that you know, I mean, I know all this goes on in me, and I have to, everything I'm telling you right now, folks, I shove it in my own face all the time. I do. My wife even said to me the other day, she said, Randy, you are way harder on yourself than you are anybody else when it comes to the Lord. And I said, I sure am. Way, way, way harder. You would hate me. You already do. Okay, some do. You would beat a hasty trail out of here right now if I treated you anything like I treat myself over the Lord. I want Jesus. And I am patient with you. Really, you may not think so. I'm incredibly patient. Because it's Jesus. It's the fruit of the Spirit. It's not me. But I have no time for patience in me. My God, it seems like just yesterday I came to a revelation of Christ and I'm already, you know, forget pushing 60, I'm beating the heck out of it. You know, life hadn't passed me by. It sideswiped me on the way out. But I mean, honestly, it just seems like a short time ago, I was just a kid coming to a revelation of Christ, and I groan within myself at what I don't have at this point. And so you still, you know, many of you still have the luxury of youth, and you go, oh, this will last forever, and sparkle, magic, woofle dust. You know. It's all right. It's all right. But I don't. I just know. I can't. No. Stop it. Stop that thought right now. Get back to the cross. You know where you're supposed to be. You know where your mind's supposed to be. You know where your heart is. You're not willing to leave Jesus over this issue and go off and be something different while lying to yourself and everyone else. No, you get up, boy, and you get back over there and you get on your knees until Christ gets hold of you. You know? That's your, you know. David said to his soul, why art thou cast down, O my soul? Get up and hope thou in God. I know you don't have any hope in you. Get up, shut up, and go after Jesus. What a privilege to be able to do that, you know? I mean, you could just be biding your time somewhere else. But God put you in the pressure cooker. Did you know that? He did. Because why? Because number one, he loves you. But number two, I think he must believe in you to some degree. I really do. I really believe that he believes in you. I really believe, you know, we're always talking about believing in him. He could not do the things he does to some of you unless he really thought that your heart is way more for him than whatever you're going through. They said in Song of Solomon, draw us, we will run. Just one sign, Bride's all over him like a chicken on a June bug. Draw us. But that's all it takes. When your heart is there, that's all it takes. It's just. It is no longer sitting in a church service going, and the Lord's going, oh, you know, he's all over your shoulder. Come on, please soften. No, they did me wrong. Well, yeah, but you know, these nail-scarred hands rubbing your flesh. My God, the shame of it. But nonetheless, you know, come on, don't be so, well, we knock Jesus back, you know. Well, did you see what they did? You know, and Jesus doesn't even say to us, did you see what they did to me? He doesn't even say that, does he? Come on, does he? He doesn't even say that to us. He doesn't. At least for me, he doesn't, you know. He just goes, you know, because why? He's after our heart. He's not trying to just convict us and beat us into submission. He just wants our heart. And so there comes a time, because we all go through that, don't we? Where there's, you know, I'm just stubborn and doggone. I don't care if, you know, I don't care if Jesus walked in here and sat in my lap. I'm set in my way right now, and that's just the way it's going to be. Give me a little while, you know, a month, and I'll be better. Well, it doesn't take too many of those months. They run into years. And I'm telling you, he's not trying to scare us or do that. He will always draw us with bands of love. I knew you when you were in the wilderness, and I drew you with bands of love. The wilderness. Does it get any worse than the children of Israel in the wilderness? And yet he's drawing with bands of love. He's drawing into his place. He's drawing into the land of promise, to land of milk and honey. It is. And you can feast, but you don't just feast. While you feast, his banner is over you, and it's love. And it's not just his love for you. Your bride, your one, your highest goal is to exhibit the one that you're one with. It's just precious. He's precious. Set apart, he said. Set apart. At that time, I set apart Levi to bear. Don't you know that word bear means more than just, you know, tiptoe through the tulips? To bear the Ark of the Covenant. To bear the presence of the Lord. The presence of the Lord. I was thinking about that the other day when I read in one of the scriptures, and it said something like they were talking, and he said that I might see his face. And what they meant was the person that we're talking about is not present. Is not present. I want to see them. I want to see them. And that means they're present. And the Spirit of God spoke to me and said, we say the presence of the Lord is here because we feel it. You know, I feel the Lord. You know, and we get goosebumps, and you know, he's here. I'm not sure where. Yeah. Dude, He's here. Check under the sofa. You know. But he described knowing the presence of the Lord because you see him. Because I see him, I know he is present. That's the presence of the Lord. And a whole lot of people talk about the presence of the Lord but have never seen Jesus. They've never seen Jesus. Jesus finally said, I'm going to the cross. When some foreigners came up, when Israel rejected him and some foreigners came up and said, sir, we would see Jesus. And his answer, and it says he answered unto them, now is the Son of Man glorified. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a grain of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, I'm going to get many more like me. See, he's going, I can do miracles for you. Do you understand his words? I can do miracles for you. I can fix your circumstance. I can make everything feel better, but you won't be after my kind. But because you want to see me, then you're going to see me at the cross, and you'll be changed into my image. Because unless I fall into the ground and die, there's only going to be this one seed, and I'm it. But if I die, the fruit, folks, for wheat is more seed. It's a proliferation of the one. Not I, but Christ. Not I, but Christ. Not I, but Christ. Not I, but Christ. Born again of incorruptible seed. Born again of incorruptible seed. Born again of incorruptible seed. It is the replenishing of the earth with life. Not just warm bodies. Not just stubborn people that, you know, are trying to be happy. What? How is that any different than the world? It's not. And that's why they're not set apart. That's why the priesthood has failed. The priest, and of all the subjects, think about it, of all the subjects that have been pushed from the forefront to the back room, being priest is one of them. The real meaning I'm talking about. You don't even hear of it, hardly. You don't even hear people talk about being a priest other than praying at a service or something. You know? It's just amazing. But he said, not just to bear the Ark of the Covenant, I have made you my priests to bear the Ark of the Covenant and to stand and minister, stand before me to minister to me. So many people want the Lord to minister to them. I feel like I've been in the presence of the Lord. I had an experience when I was very, very young in the Lord where I knelt down in the living room of my house in Oak Cliff and I began to pray to him and I began to pour out all of my issues. And I remember looking up into his face. And it was just like I could see him. And he had a look on his face. And I just kept talking, you know, Lord, help me with this. I mean, that's the way I was taught to pray, you know. Go in there, tell him what you need, and get out. And I saw his face, and I saw a look that I didn't fully understand, and so I just kept praying. And as I kept looking, I realized that I had always gone in there and never ministered to him, ever. Not at that point, not one time, every thought in me was always to get in there and tell him what I needed and get out. And I stopped. And it was like everything just fell down around me. And I just said, Jesus, I'm sorry. And I said, I want to minister to you. What can I do for you? What can I do for others that would so bless you? What can I, you know? And I just started changing my prayers after that because I just knew that that was so right. And that's what a priest does. They go in to minister to the Lord. They're not there to get something. They are there to give something to God. There's no way this class will never cover it, but I've spent some time studying out the different sacrifices, offerings, and gifts. What an incredible study. What it is that we give and how specific it is, but it is, and you're not even a priest unless you understand specifically what will satisfy him. You know, because then you're just throwing stuff at him. You're saying, well, be satisfied with what I'm trying to give you here. You know, to minister to him. And it said, and to bless in his name. I thought, can it get any better? To really honestly bear his name, to do all we do, hardly, in his name. Can it get any better to be married to Jesus, to be one with Jesus, to be after his kind, to be a branch to his vine, to draw in the sweetest vine of all vines within us? And then to disseminate that out, to bless in his name, because we no longer come in our name, for our name. Nobody may call you Mrs. Jesus. But you got every right for that name because you are his. It is your name. It is who you are. I don't care what you've done. I don't care what your failures are. You are one with Jesus. He died because he loves you, and he lives, and you live, so he can keep loving you. Love him back. Love him back. And then once you've done that, I promise you, you stay in his presence long enough, you will find yourself going out from his presence and loving other people around you. And they will be benefactors. And that's good. That's good. It's good. It's good. Because it's the flow of the living water coming out of the throne of the slain Lamb, that comes out of the city, the New Jerusalem, the bride, which is us, and then flows to bring healing to the nations. It doesn't just come from the Lamb, and it doesn't just come from the throne. It comes from out of her, because he's seated, enthroned inside of her, and it just brings healing to so many things, and yet we make the healing everything, don't we? You know, it touches this and it's healed. Everywhere the waters went, it brought healing. It says that. So we just go, oh, stand up, sister, and let's hear the testimony. Why don't stand up and let's hear the testimony of the bride? Not the results, but the testimony of, I don't want anyone else in my heart. Not in my heart. I don't want anyone else flowing out of me. I want him flowing, flowing, flowing. And when other people are touched by it and they come to the walls of this city, sure, you know, listen to his words about Jerusalem, you know, listen to the scriptures all about Jerusalem. You know, great is the Lord and greatly to be praised in the city of our God. In the mountain of his holiness, talking about Zion. Great is the Lord, not just great is the Lord, great is the Lord and greatly to be praised in the city of our God, in the mountain of his holiness. Beautiful for situation. The joy of the whole earth is Mount Zion in the sides of the north, the city of the great king. That's us. That's us. That's the bride. That's us. You know. He says, you know, come, look at her bulwarks. It says many things, but one of it is, come, look at her bulwarks, talking about the bulwarks of of Jerusalem, of Zion. Well, what is that? A bulwark is a strong building up against the enemy should the enemy attack, should the enemy come in and say, Nebuchadnezzar is king here, Nebuchadnezzar is the king in this city. No, 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 we have defenses against that. We, you know, he gloried in her bulwarks. He said, look, she has resistance against all of this stuff. The whole shame of the book of Nehemiah was that city and that temple. The walls of the city were burned and torn down, and Sanballat and Tobiah and all the enemies could just walk, waltz in. You know, you don't have any walls up, you don't have any bulwarks up, you don't have any standards, you don't have all of that set in place. No, I have only Jesus, and you're building that up every time you do it, every time you fall in love with him a little more, every time you be Levi and you cut off a little more flesh off yourself, you're falling in love with him just a little bit more, and it's building up those bulwarks until the enemy comes up to bull rush you, and he hits you, and he falls back because there is no way. There is no way he can get in there. There is no way. And you remember the story of the Rabshakeh that came with all of the armies from Nebuchadnezzar. It wasn't Nebuchadnezzar. It was Assyria, and. You know, showed all of the armies and said, you're just a little city, you're just a little bride with a little king, with a little, you know, and you can't stand against these armies. Did the city so-and-so, did Ramah, which was greater than this one, did this city, which was greater, did this country stand? No, none of them stood, and you're not going to stand either. There's no hope. You are overwhelmed. It's too much. And who was it? Hezekiah? Hezekiah goes and he takes the letter that he came with it, takes it and lays it before the Lord. Lays it before the Lord. He doesn't lay it before himself and go, okay, well, you're right on that point. I don't measure up, and boy, I could never whoop you, and you know, that's right, and you know, you guys are trained assassins and we're just farmers, and my God, okay, open the gates. Let them in. You know, instead, take it, lay it before the Lord, and said, he's not talking about us. He's talking about you. Do you remember that? That's basically what he said. He's not talking about us. He's not insulting us. We're you. We're one with you. That's not going to change. We will never open the gates. They may come in and they may destroy us, but it won't be because we give in to this bulwarks. You know, it is, Lord, he's talking about you. This army is too great for us. We are not able to stand before them. But we trust in you. We believe that we are your bride, your people. And he's trying to take that away from our heart, and we will not let it go. Well, then what? What are you going to do now? The Lord's going to show up now. Just give him a little faith. Just trust him a little bit. Trust him a little bit. Just say, this isn't about me. This isn't about me. This isn't about my circumstances right now. This is about Jesus, and this is nothing more than the enemy trying to rip all this from me. And if I don't have the bulwarks right now, I need to start working on them. Can I get amen for that one? If I don't have it now, I can't do anything about yesterday or the day before. I can't do anything about it. If I've had, you know, I always tell people, this is a 15-round bout, folks. He can knock you down and knock you all over the ring the first round, and it ain't over with. You can go 15 rounds and get one punch in and knock him out, and you win. And he beat you like a red-headed stepchild. My God. And you're still standing for the Lord. How about this? Rocky, Rocky, Rocky. You know? you say, look, man, I told the story about the boxer that got in there, and the other boxer was knocking him all over the place. And when he got back to his corner, he sat down, and his coach said, he says, man, you're doing great. You're really doing great out there. And he said, what are you talking about, man? I'm bleeding the nose. I got black eyes and everything. I've been knocked all over the thing. He said, you better check the ref, because somebody's beating the fool out of me. Well, you know, I personally know what I'm talking about. I would like to tell you this is all hogwash, but I have been knocked all over the place. I have been, you know, I have been, the picture that I feel sometimes is like somebody took a sock and they took a Coke bottle and they put it in the sock and they just beat it up against a concrete wall. That I felt like my outer was the sock and everything within me was broken glass. I mean, I felt so beat up and bruised and whatever. And I learned in those times that the only thing that counts is Jesus. The only thing. And I don't, you know, and it's at that point that you finally let go of everything. You just let go. I don't care anymore. I don't care about that. I only care about you. I don't care about that. I don't care about this. That was my pride. That's what it was. It was nothing more than my pride. And I let go of my pride. And I just said, you know, as long as I can be with you, I don't care how I look to anybody else. I don't care how beat up I get. And there is healing in the arms of the Lord. Do you believe that? There's healing in the arms of the Lord. I'd just rather be with Him. 24 hours a day. I don't get 24 hours a day to search the Scriptures. I don't get 24 hours a day to walk around feeling the presence of the Lord. But I get 24 hours a day of being one with Jesus. And it's beautiful. Beautiful for situation. Did you know it said that? Now, that's a beautiful situation. I'm with Jesus. And right now, maybe the Lord's having me share this with you to pick you up. Maybe you've been knocked around a little bit. I'm telling you, nothing is worth leaving the heart of Jesus over. Nothing. There is nothing too hard or too horrible that is worth giving up being after His kind. Because being after His kind, folks, has a lot of benefits to us, but being after His kind is actually more for His satisfaction than it is for ours. He draws tremendous strength. You don't believe me? He does. And tremendous, he's just overwhelmed. You can read it in the Song of Solomon. Thou art fair. There is one verse that he says, to look on you, and basically the way that it's written in the Hebrews, it is so overwhelming, I am having a hard time continuing to look at you. I just want to drop my eyes, not because I don't want to see you, but I'm becoming jello. You know? Well, you know what? I'd rather be jello in the hands of Jesus than a mighty man of valor that really is not with the Lord. That's how I feel about it. Oh, well, let's see. Maybe I've got a few more scriptures here. How much time we got left back there? 17 minutes. For God's sake, turn with me to chapter 33. Here, I felt like I'd said something. I guess I hadn't really said anything yet. Deuteronomy 33. And let's look at verse 8 through 11. This is an interesting scripture now. If you don't follow the person changes on it, it's going to really throw you. But if you follow the person changes, it's really cool. And of Levi, he said, let thy Thummim and thy Urim be with thy Holy One. That's the high priest. He's talking to the sons of Levi here, see? And of Levi, he said. Okay? So he's talking to the priest. Who is the Holy One of the priests? The high priest, Jesus. Right? Who wears Urim and Thummim? Who knows what it's all about? The Lord shared some great stuff with me. I shared it in Mexico. Some of you were there. And of Levi said, let thy Thummim and thy Urim be with the Holy One, not with you, with him. That means you seek him, you don't seek answers. Whom thou didst prove at Massa, and with whom thou didst strive at the waters of Meribah. Speaking now of them, who said unto his father and to his mother, I have not seen him, neither did he acknowledge his brethren, nor knew his own children. Now he's going to talk about Levi, because he's talking to them. For they have observed thy word and kept thy covenant. They shall teach Jacob thy judgments. Jacob, thy judgments, and Israel, thy law. It would be interesting for you to see the difference. It's the same person. Jacob and Israel are the same person. One is Jacob before he's seen the Lord and changed. He is a manipulator. He needs the judgments. Israel has the law of God written on his heart. They shall put incense before thee and whole burnt sacrifice upon thine altar. Bless, Lord, his substance. Hallelujah. And accept the work of his hands. You see, not just any work, this work. Smite through the loins of them that rise up against him, and of them that hate him, that they rise not again. All right, and then maybe I'll try to close with a little bit here in Malachi. Turn with me to the last book of the Old Testament. If you can find Matthew and then go backwards, you'll bump into Malachi. He's standing right next to him. Malachi chapter 2. Now, Malachi is a most precious book. It is incredibly precious for this reason. Many people do not know this. The book of Malachi is written to the tribe of Levi. It's written to the priests. It is not about anything else primarily, but a book to priests who have left the true meaning of their being. It is an incredible, incredible book when you read it in light of that. And that's the light that it was written in. Malachi chapter 2, and let's look in verse 4. Let's do 4 and 5, see what that says. You shall know that I have sent this commandment unto you, that my covenant might be with Levi, saith the Lord of hosts. My covenant was with him of life and peace. And I gave them to him for the fear which he feared me and was afraid before my name. The law of truth was in his mouth. And iniquity was not found in his lips. You know what iniquity is, don't you? It's not just saying filthy words or something. Iniquity is lawlessness. It means not being under the law of love, not being under the nature of the Lamb. The law of truth was in his mouth, and iniquity was not found in his mouth. He walked with me in peace and equity, and did turn many from iniquity. Let's keep reading. For the priest's lips should keep knowledge, and they should seek the law at his mouth. For he is the messenger of the Lord of hosts. What's the message? Christ. But you have departed out of the way. You have caused many to stumble at the law. You have corrupted the covenant of Levi. This is not the general covenant. This is the priesthood, saith the Lord of hosts. Therefore have I also made you contemptible and base before all the people, according as you have not kept my ways, but have been partial in the law. I love this thought. My covenant was with him of life and peace. If life is not flowing and if we do not have peace, then we're probably in turmoil. So, finally, because this is Malachi, finally, remember the order now. It's been two classes. We started with just individuals who were the priest over their family. Then we started with a whole nation in the desire of God's heart, not their desire. They didn't even know what a priest was. The desire of God, God initiating to try to communicate the whole nation. I want all of you to be this way. I don't want some to be closer. I want all to be this way. Reduce that down to a tenth, a remnant. Broke his heart. You read about it in here and why. And then all of a sudden it comes to the book of Malachi, the last book before it gets to the new covenant. And in the new covenant, God says, that's it. I'm putting away now all of this priesthood too. I'm putting away it all. And I'm going to raise up a new priesthood. I'm going to raise up those that will really be after my kind, a peculiar people. That's what it means. To be after his kind means to be a peculiar people, or to be a peculiar people means to be after his kind, and it means specifically to be a priest. It's always connected in that same sentence, that you were meant to be a peculiar people, a people that gave themselves peculiarly to giving me the Lamb. All the time, all day, whole burnt offerings, morning, evening, you know, when the sun comes up, when it goes down. Let not the sun go down on your wrath. What does that mean? I'll tell you what it means. Don't withhold the evening sacrifice from me. You know, we go, well, I went to bed mad. You know, well, that's one thing, but that could be a law thing. Well, I went to bed mad and I shouldn't have done it. No, folks, we're in the new covenant. To violate it is violating much higher realities. That's the shadow. We're supposed to be the living reality. We are. And so, you know, now these are issues of the heart. They're issues of his heart. They're not just issues of right and wrong, law, good and bad, and keeping the law. These are issues, you know, withholding the evening sacrifice would have wrought incredible problems for Israel. God wanted the Lamb constantly going, and the Father's up there, and he's getting that because the burnt offering was a sweet savor offering, not a sin offering. It is just how the Lamb, what I'm talking about is, it's not giving himself because you did something wrong. It's how he is. He's just, the Father loves that nature. The Father loves that self-giving nature. And so that's what it all represents. And so he's up there, and there's Israel's down there. And you can see, I mean, even like in the book of Numbers when, you know, they were passing through the land, and when they were before they got to the land, they were in the wilderness, and they were doing everything wrong, but they kept defeating their enemies, and all the people started getting afraid. So they finally came to Moab, and the king of Moab came up with an idea. He said, nobody's been able to defeat these people, so let's go get a guy, let's go get a prophet, and let's have him curse Israel, and if God's cursed him, then he'll be cursed. And so they got him, Balaam, and Balaam came, and he stood, and he began to try to curse him, and when he tried to speak, all but blessing came out. And he said all this blessing, and now the king's sitting there and said, I brought you from a far place here, and I promised you a certain amount of money to curse them, and you're blessing them. And he said, God is not a man that he should lie. He ain't like us, neither the Son of Man that he should repent. Hath he said, and shall he not do it? Hath he promised, and shall he not make it good? Behold, he said, I have received commandment to bless, because he hath blessed, and I cannot reverse it. And then he said, when God looks upon Israel, he does not behold iniquity in her. Folks, I'm telling you, there was sin going on, junk, selfishness. Can anybody, you know what I mean? But the priests were given that burnt offering day and night, and the father's just up there going like this. I don't know what your problem is, Balaam. You understand what I'm saying? He's smelling the sweet fragrance of Christ, and he's looking at this guy and going, I'm not sure what you're cursing, but you better not be cursing my son. Because you're one with the Son. You're not just a friend. You're one with the Son. And the goal is, you know, the goal was for all of them to be priests, though. Remember? By that time, Levi was the only priest. There shouldn't have been. Every one of them should have been an altar. Not an altar for sin. An altar of offering that sweet savor to the Father. Here's your son. Here's your son. Here's your son. Here's your son. And the Father's just going, for you are a sweet savor unto God of Christ. That's what the Scriptures declare. For you are a sweet savor unto God. That's the wording. Forget forget what everybody else thinks. You know, there's just too much worrying about what everybody else thinks. There is. There's just too much worrying about what everybody else thinks. Go after Jesus. Get after him. Run. He's drawing. He is drawing. Will you run? That's what he says. Because, folks, he put away this priesthood. Then he put away this one. He put away the priesthood of the patriarchs. Then he put away the priesthood of all of Israel. Then he put away the priesthood of the Levites. And now there's only one priesthood. And we're supposed to be doing the real thing, offering up spiritual sacrifices acceptable unto God by Jesus Christ. New Testament scripture. Boom. There it is. There's the reality. Anything else is, we say, well, it's all fulfilled. Fulfilled is different than he's filling us full. It's not fulfilled in that it has no validity, folks. I'll get into this next time. It's not fulfilled in that it has no validity. It has incredible validity, but only as a shadow to show us what the real is. In itself, it has no validity, but it has incredible validity for us to really see the real meaning of what this New Testament priesthood is supposed to be about every day, folks. Those priests didn't offer sacrifices every Sunday morning. They offered them every day. And they kept it going, and they kept it going. And you know, you say, well, we don't have to offer lambs and all this kind of stuff. That's right. We don't have to offer lambs and goats and everything. We have to offer one lamb that is acceptable. It always was the only sacrifice that God ever accepted. All the others were only pictures of that. And as long as they said, this is a picture of that, God said, I accept my son then. But when they lost that, and I can show you places all over the Old Testament, especially through the prophets, where they lost that. They lost it. And now they're offering. They were still offering, folks, but they lost the real meaning of it. Now it's just them doing stuff for God and hoping God would accept. I'll show you scriptures that there it says that they're offering their things to God, and God is saying to them, you're offering me these things, but it has nothing to do with me. It has everything to do with you. You know? So, anyway, just this thought, it would be a good study sometime in your life to really think about the things that's been shared in this class and then go to Malachi and really do a thorough study of the book of Malachi, because by that time, God gets down to the end. Think about it. This is the last book of the Old Covenant, the last book, and the main people he just wants to talk to is his priests, and he's just broken hearted. It's just, he's just brokenhearted. This isn't about the failures of the people. Jeremiah covered all of that and everything, but it gets down to the end, and he's just like broken down. It's like he can't wait for Jesus to come and the cross to happen, because even the priests, even those who should have truth in their mouth, even those who should keep knowledge, even those the people should be able to seek the law at their mouth are not giving the proper sacrifices. And it's pretty powerful. So may the Lord quicken that thought to you later in your life to search some of these things out. Father, I just thank you for your Holy Spirit. And I pray, Father, for each heart that finds you more precious than anything else. I pray not for them that are in the world, but I pray for those that you've chosen out of the world. Those who, Lord, find you more precious than anything else.